All right, and so, okay, so we're recording. So there's already some people in chat, which is awesome. Thanks again for tuning in. This is episode two of Let's Build a Hypercard RPG. I haven't really thought too much about what we're gonna do in this episode, but I have some notes that I kind of scrolled down a while back, so maybe we can kind of use this as a jumping off point. So let's boot up the emulator. Right. Hopefully everything is gonna work. This is taking an awfully long time. Maybe it's fine. Okay, cool. All right. So just a reminder, we're emulating a Mac Classic running System 7.5.3, which is basically exactly in the environment that I cut my teeth on using HyperCard years and years ago. So it's authentic at least from my end, but it's all running in an emulator. It's the same emulator that the Internet Archive uses, but not the JavaScript version. So if you want to follow along at home, you can totally just use the Internet Archive's disk images. You should have everything that you need. Okay, so just so we all get it acquainted about what we built last time, also for my benefit, why don't we just sort of review all the cards in the HyperCard stack that we have so far. So this is the title screen. It's the first card. We don't have anything there yet, but I think at some point we'll put something fun there. I'm just going to start scrolling through the cards. So this is the game card. I think we gave it the name game. So this is where we rendered all the novel images on top of each other when we want to construct a novel view. Yeah, that right. Then after that we have the card of global variables. I see that we, I guess because we quit and started again, we lost a player position and player direction, so we'll have to generate those again, but that's fine. So anytime we have a global variable, I'll make a new field on this card just so we can see everything all at once. These cards, this is what we drew, I think, in the zeroth episode. These are all the walls that we can possibly see. And I think probably it's worth doing some shading on these farther away ones, just so it looks a little bit, yeah, something like a fog effect. But we haven't. Maybe we can do that maybe towards the end when we're tired of looking at HyperTalk code. And then so after the end of the last stream, I rejigged a little bit of stuff here in this window. But this is a map card. So what we're going to have down here will be like a two-dimensional sort of text representation of a map. So for instance, we have something like X's to represent walls and empty spaces to represent like empty tiles. And I think probably we'll have things like items later on represented, with other characters. Yeah, so let's actually, I was playing around with some stuff, so we'll get rid of that. I think just in order to get us started, because I haven't done any HyperCards since the last stream, and I kind of need to get back into the action here. So why don't we do something that would have been nice to have in the last stream, which is some navigation buttons to take us like back and forth between like the global variable card and the game card and the map card and the game card. The reason why is just because it's kind of a nuisance to kind of scroll back and forth with the arrow keys here. Also, it's kind of hard for you to see what I'm doing just because like I know where I'm kind of scrolling back and forth between in the game. Sorry, in the stack, but maybe it's not intuitive if you're a viewer. So we're going to create two new buttons here. I'm going to stick them out of the way down here. So let's call this one map. Oh, I wonder if. Is there an icon that represents a map that we can use here? If not, we can just keep it just saying map in text form. It doesn't look like there is, which is a bummer. I guess we could draw something, but that's okay. Okay, so I'll have it say map. So what we're going to do is when we click the button, so it's kind of funny. Obviously we have a HyperCard stack, which is a collection of cards, but there's also another stack of sorts, which are sort of the cards you're currently interacting with. So if I push card, what it is that kind of puts us on like a logical stack. So then if other cards want to pop the card that we pushed on previously, it'll take us back to where we started. So it's kind of a nice way of remembering where we've gone. So we're going to push the current card and go to card, I think we called it map. And obviously this only really works if we have one map in the whole game, so we might have to change this later on. But just for the time being, that should be fine. So let me make this a little bit smaller. And if we click it, it should just take us to the map card. Okay, cool. Now I'm going to add another button to get us to go back. Oops. Oh, we're forget I've forgotten a very important thing, which is the very 90s soundtrack. No one had any good suggestions, or no one provided any suggestions in the Twitter stream. So I'm just putting on some pulp for some Britpop goodness, so hopefully that's okay. So now this is going to be the button that takes us back. So why don't we do that? So all this button is going to do is when we click it, it's going to pop card. So it'll take us back to whatever card we most recently pushed. There we go. So I'm going to do the same thing for the global variables. Is there no. What do you call it? Oh, debug. Well, let's rename it. Fine. So if we click it takes us there, and we'll need another back button as well. So I'm just going to copy and paste this button entirely. So that works as it should. That was kind of a nice warm-up just for me to try and remember how everything works here. Take a sip of my tasty beverage, homemade kombucha. Tart. All right. So, I was thinking it would be fun to randomly generate maps. And so I sketched some notes about how we could like randomly generate a map like in this text field. So I think maybe, yeah, why don't we get started with that? And so the idea is that we're going to write it's kind of like the opposite of a maze traversal algorithm. It's like a maze gener yes, homemade kombucha. It's saves me a lot of money when I can have a 4-gallon jug in the kitchen to sip on at all times. So this will be just like a recursive descent map generator. As I said, I wrote some notes, so hopefully this will be enough to translate the notes into HyperTalk. So because it's going to be like a recursive walk through the map. Actually, I'm kind of getting ahead of myself. So kind of what we'll do is we'll first have when we click this generate random map button, we'll create basically a map that's just nothing but walls, kind of like this. And then what we'll do is we'll take some point in the map, replace it with a square, and then kind of pop all its or push all its neighbors onto a stack, and then just sort of recurse, right? So then, oops, yeah, the arrow keys don't work in a field, which is kind of annoying. So then we might change that one, and we might randomly change that one, and so on and so on. Because we don't have a stack data structure, what I'm going to do is I'm going to create another text field kind of over here. And we're going to like push and pop elements in this stack. What should I say? In this field. So we'll sort of kind of conceptually, you know, if we add, oh, let me make this not transparent. We could do this with a variable, but I think it's kind of nice to have a more visual representation because this will otherwise maybe get a little hard to see. So when we push elements onto the stack, you know, we'll just say like the next position to process could be like 2, 3 or 3, 4. Okay. Right. Oh, geez. Right. So then when it comes time to add a new element, we'll hit return and do like 3, 2, something like that. And when we process elements, we kind of do the opposite. We grab the first line from the text field and delete it. And I just noticed that I am doing this as a card field, which is not what I want. So I'm going to go into background. And I'm going to call this field gen stack. It's the maze generation stack. Why not? This will get pretty deep, so maybe we make the text a little bit smaller. Maybe that'll be nice to have. Okay. So now let's write the maze generation algorithm. So it'll happen when we click the generate random map button. So I guess it would be nice to prompt the user for like how big the user wants the map to be. So we'll do ask dimensions of map. And we'll do is put the first, so let me be clear what this means. So this will ask pops up a dialog box that the user can type into. So they can put something like 5, 5 to say like 5 columns and 5 rows. So the first item of it into calls and put the second item of it into rows. So it is like a special, I guess it's like dollar sign underscore in Perl. It's like this globally mutatable thing that just sort of that implicitly gets modified by random stuff. So the result of ask gets put into it. Okay. So I guess then we'll need to zap out put into the background field. I don't remember what I called them because I have a short-term memory. Tiles. Okay, I'm gonna write that down. So So where we're gonna put the random map is gonna be in tiles, and this is gen stack. Okay. Cool. So put into BG field tiles and put into, I don't think the should be there, BG field gen stack. Okay. So the first thing we want to do is we want to fill out the map with nothing but wall tiles. So for, repeat with I equals 1, 2 rows, I guess. And then repeat with J equals 1, 2 calls. Okay. So once we have that, we are going to put X, which is our symbol for walls, into item J of row I of background field tiles. Okay. So let's just see what that looks like when we actually try and click it. Okay, so if I do 10, 10, let's say. Oh, okay. Well, great. It's line I, not row I. I will do that all the time. Aha. I see. So the problem was that I was in the background. So it was getting modified over here, and I couldn't see it. So let's try that again. I'll do 5-5. Okay, cool. So that works as it should. Oh yeah, so then I guess we can also ask like where the starting location should be. So ask starting location. You can say 2-2. And then what we'll do is we'll put it into background field gen stack. Right, so this is like the one thing that we have to process. Let's just see if this works. And 2-2, let's say. Great. Cool. So, oh, yeah. So I guess we have to do a little bit more than this. The reason why, let me explain. So just to show with a big map, the problem is that we kind of need to alternate. I guess it doesn't matter. We kind of need to alternate between spaces for the player to walk and walls. So something kind of like this, unfortunately. So this would be like a corridor, and this is like a wall of sorts. So basically what this means is we need to eat two rows at a time. So for instance, if we're here right now and we want to generate a corridor to the east, it's not just enough to eat this character, we also have to eat this one here, because we need to indicate that there should be like the wall also needs to disappear. And not just, yeah, if that kind of makes sense. So let's do something like, I'm not sure what the right way to do this is, but let's say, okay, so the stack will hold, every row is going to be two elements then, I guess. So if we want to eat, so every time we push something into the wall, it'll be like, for instance, if we were here and we wanted to sort of extend the map here, we would have 5-3 and 6-3, right? So it would look like 5-3, 6-3. I'm sorry, dang it. Conceptually, these are like two separate things. Okay. So that's a little awkward. So let's just assume that our starting location is always going to be 2-2. Maybe we can refactor this a little bit later. So let's do put 2-2. Let's say we're kind of eating it from the south into BG field gen stack. Okay. Let's just try this again. Okay, great. So, because this is GenStack is our sort of conceptual stack, we're going to have to keep processing items off the stack until the stack's empty, right? So, repeat while the number of lines of BG field gen stack is greater than 0. Okay, so we're going to pop item, and we're going to put line 1 of BG field gen stack into cur line. Sure. And then put item 1 of per line into item 1 is the column. Put item 2 of per line into into row. Okay. Oh, shoot. But this is, like, call one. Oh, this is kind of annoying, but okay. So we'll sort of take apart these four elements here. Yeah, maybe we can refactor this thing a little bit. Okay. Then what we're going to want to do is delete item one. Oh no, line one. Line one. BG field gen stack. Okay, so let's try this. So it should generate the map and then do stuff behind the scenes, and we should lose. Yes, good. So we saw that item get added to the stack and then popped off immediately. Great. So the case where we don't want to do any work is when. Let's see. So I guess we are right 2-2 and 3-2. And I guess if we've already visited either, then we're just not gonna do any work. I think that's right. Right? That's kinda like the base case where if like we've already visited some node in like a graph traversal, then just return early. So let's write something like base case elements already visited. You know, the thought occurs that, you know, anytime I have to do like a phone screen coding challenge for my next job, I should just send them one of these videos and have that count. Okay, so base case is elements already visited, so. Oh man, if. Oh, we also need to make sure we don't walk off the end of the wall. Okay, so. Base case is also going to be edge of map. Alright, so. If call one is less than or equal to one, because the outermost one will be sort of the edge of the map. We always kind of want that filled in. So if call one is less than one, or call one is greater than or equal to calls, or row one is less than or equal to one, or row one. Hello, Noraya1. Thanks for tuning in. One row is greater than rows, then next repeat. And if. And we'll need to do the same thing for call two and row two. It's kind of annoying that we don't have like more structured types for this, because I think there's going to be a lot of code duplication here. Okay. So. Elements already visited, that's cool. So if item call one of line row one of BG field really forgotten tiles is not empty, then next repeat. And we're going to want to do the same, I think, for either. Is that right? Maybe it's just call two, because we're kind of hopping every two. For every two elements? I don't know. Well, I guess we can always try it and see how it works. Okay. So. Do that. Okay, so then cursive case is going to be, we're going to find neighbors push onto stack, Oh, that there's a point. Oh, okay. Because we want this to be a random map. Oh. Hello, Wakana Nobaka. Hello, sir. Can you please be showing how to write the mist? Unfortunately, the computer is only the emulator only handles black and white. But I kind of thought about doing like a mist clone. Yeah, maybe next. I have a couple ideas for what to do after the RPG stream kind of runs its course. Yeah. Yes, hello. Well, I don't think you were in the stream last time, so welcome. As I was saying, because we want the map to be random, we kind of want to choose a direction at random. So what I'm going to do is I need another data structure of sorts. So I'm just going to do this. So what I'm going to do is we're going to, we'll push the direction, like the coordinates for north, south, east, west onto another field, and then randomly choose ones to push back into the other stack. So it's kind of like we're permuting like the order and that will recurse. So this will be, I don't know, curse stack. Why not? I'm a great namer of things. Okay. So. Okay. So what we're going to do is. So let's just see how this works. So if we are, for instance, if we are right here and we want to go north, we're in the same column, but minus one on the line, right? Because, yeah, okay. So what we're going to do is northward is going to be call row minus one and call row minus two. Eastward is going to be column going to the right? Call plus one row and call plus two row. And then actually, let's put south right there because it's kind of the same thing, right? Like we have plus one. So minus one, I think this is right. Okay, so for northward, this is going to be a whole lot of copying and pasting, which is annoying. Let's see. So put call. So this is the ampersand, the string concatenation. So column and row minus one into, I don't know, chords. And then put new chords ampersand. Okay, let's line that up so that's a little bit easier to read. Okay, so once we have that, we're going to, we need to add it to the end of, damn it, what did I call it? This one was called cur stack? Okay, cur stack. Winchcraft asks, what are the other scripting languages available to me? right now only HyperTalk. I think it's somehow you can use AppleScript, but that doesn't seem to be available. Yeah, only HyperTalk. You can also write native extensions, which I thought would be fun to do maybe down the road, but you need a C compiler for this. And then basically you just make like calls into like native code. So arguably Pascal and C, but right now, unfortunately, only just HyperTalk. Yeah. Okay, so we need to add the end. To put the number of lines of BG field cur stack into stack length, I don't know. And then put put new cord into line sln plus one of BG field cur stack. Okay, so I'm going to comment out the end repeat thing. I just want to make sure that this is kind of doing the thing you expect. All right. Oh, found next repeat. Oh, yeah. Oh, this is annoying. So I guess I can't. I'll just set a breakpoint, which is really the better practice anyway. So, I don't know if we got a chance to use the debugger in part one, but this is pretty, it's a pretty nice development environment, given that it was kind of for amateurs and written in the 80s. So let's do 5.5. Interesting, the breakpoint didn't trigger. Okay, so that's a sign that something's goofy. Well, in that case, let's set a breakpoint here and see what happens. So, 5.5. Okay. Let's see if we can kind of. I'm just going to step through here. Okay. Oh, let's actually open up our variable watcher so we can see what we got here. Okay. That's all great. So none of these next repeats should fire. If there is, then I screwed up. Oh, that should be if it equals empty, because that means we've already visited it. Right, okay. I did that badly. Equals. 5. So now when we step, none of the base cases should fire. Great. Oh, I expected number here. Oh, that's usually because I didn't initialize a variable correctly. Let's see. Is call. I guess. So let's see, what have we done here? So this means that this is the. That's the sort of a wall thing that we're. Like the wall tile we're blowing away, and this is like the actual next position. Okay, So then instead of calling it call, let's just call it call. I'm not a huge fan of this naming style. I will probably go back and give call one and row one a better name, kind of represent that they're like the wall. So yeah, that error I think usually comes up when you have like an uninitialized variable that it tries to treat as a string. It's very kind of JavaScript-y, unfortunately. So let's see if this works. Okay, so step. And then it would be nice if it could always open up the variable watcher. Okay. And then, so now new chords. This would be for northward. Yep. And then it appears. Okay, fantastic. And then, of course, this isn't... We would automatically discard this one because this hits a base case, right? Like, it's row one, which is the edge of the map. So we wouldn't actually do anything with that one, but that'll be the job for the next iteration. Okay. So hopefully everything will just sort of work when we glue sort of the recursion together. So we're not spending too much time just sort of staring at trying to implement graph traversal in HyperTalk here. So southward will be row plus one, row plus two, and then that should be, this is westward, so this will be call minus one, and just row. Call plus one, call plus two. Okay. So the thing that we should see at this stage is four items in sort of our temporary stack up here and no elements down here. The reason why... So that's five, sure, why not. Okay. Great. So now what we'll do is, because we want to visit these ones in a random order, we'll randomly choose elements to add back into the stack down here. I was thinking about this the other day, if it's easier to just sort of have one stack and move items around. I don't think it is, so. All right, so permute elements of cur stack into gen stack. Okay, so repeat while the number of lines of BG's field cur stack is greater than zero. Okay, that's cool. Now what I need to do is I need to put the random of the number of lines of BG field per stack, oh man, into, and we're out of room, so I'm going to name this thing something short. R. Fine. Cool. Then put line R of BG field cur stack into cur line, sure. Use a field cur line to cur, okay. And then we want to delete line R of BG field cur stack. And then does this work? Can I just do so how are we popping stuff off? Okay. Did we say put line one? Okay, so the line one is the top line. Or line the top of like line one is the top of the stack. I'm probably missing a close paren, yes. What makes you ask that? I don't think it'll highlight. April asks, where's Roxette? I mean, I can put Roxette back on. That was kind of a big hit last time, so. Sure. Sure. Man, Roxette had an album in 2016? I don't believe it. Alright. Alright, Greatest Hits album. Where are you? I have a lot of albums. Alright. The number of lines. Oh, yes! Wunschkraft, thank you. That would have probably been annoying to find. Or BG Field that looks. Yeah. Or BG Field that line looks like it's missing a paren. Okay. I think we're good there. I guess what this means is so the thing we're going to want to do is pop line the number of lines of thank you, Wunschkraft. That was very helpful. I think on the last stream, I spent like 10 minutes trying to find basically a syntax error, so the more the merrier. Put line the number of lines of no, let's not do that. Put line S1. Put the number of lines of VG field gen stack into S1. Okay. Great. So we'll be popping sort of from the bottom. So I think that will simplify things down here. So we delete line R, and then we have to guess we kind of have to do this again. Figured a peanut gallery linter is better than none. Yes. Put the number of lines of BG field gen stack into SLEN. Put cur line into line SLN plus one, BG field cur stack. Okay. So we did that. That's cool. One thing that I think we forgot to do, which is in the recursive case, hollow out walls. So set item call one of line call one of BG field tiles. Put blank into Okay. We would actually like to generate the map somehow. Okay, great. Okay. So we, in the recursive case, we hold out the walls, we get the neighbors into Curstack, permute Curstack into the top of Genstack, and we just keep going. Okay, I'm going to set a breakpoint here, and we can watch it work, or watch it not work, as the case may be. So we'll do 5-5, why not? You know, it occurred to me, we're not zeroing out that that field, which might be a problem. So let's here put into BG field curstack. And another thing I'm going to do is I'm going to add a scroll bar to these ones here. Because I feel like maybe it would be... Oh, that's kind of annoying. Do that. Alright. Something like that. So let's try this again. Right, because the problem was that it wasn't blowing away elements in here. Because it's saving state between runs. Well, that did something. I thought we set a breakpoint, though. Okay. Well... Let's do that. Okay, great. So, we step forward. So we get to add those elements in. So, which one does it grab? So it should have 4-2 something there, I think. Okay. All right. Okay, and then now it should delete 3334 and have 3334 into call 1, row 1, da 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 da. 3334, and then that one should go away. Okay, so what happened here? Why did we hit the... So we hit a base case here, which we shouldn't have done, I think. Oh, if item... Huh. So this one says if call... So if item call one of line... La... Okay. So item call one of line row one, that's 3-3. Interesting. I'm not convinced that's right. Let's step through some more. Okay. Huh. So we definitely screwed something up here. So we seem to be doing the early exits more... Yeah, when I wrote this, I wasn't sure if we actually wanted this one here. So let's try commenting that out. Well, let's try a bigger map, why not? Let's get rid of that breakpoint. So it's doing something, but that doesn't quite look right. Why is it just a diagonal? I feel like we're having some sort of problem here. Yeah, so we're definitely kind of walking off the end of things here. So northward. I'm still not convinced. Let's try this with a smaller map again. Okay. So we have four elements in there, I think? Yep. Okay, so the next one is going to be 4, 2, oh, wait a minute. That doesn't make sense. Okay, so I see, I think I'm probably putting things in the wrong order here. I think I may have my coordinates flipped. Let's see. Should always be column and row, right? I haven't screwed that up. Yep. I'm gonna set a breakpoint earlier here. Because we should be able to guess what the right coordinates are, right? Well, in fact, like it's even that's super goofy. Okay, give me a second here. So, 2-2 and 3-2 is not... Oh no, I bet I know what I did. I bet I copied and pasted and forgot to change one of the parameters. Oh, look at that! Yes. Row one, not call one. I have a better feeling about that now. Okay. So that's not a terribly interesting map. So let's try generating a bigger one. While I have a sip of kombucha here. It's doing something. So given how long this takes, it seems like we'd probably want to generate these sort of in advance. Because that would be kind of painful to do. Like, every time we wanted to start a new map. So what I think we will probably do is, like, the final... Whoops, almost spilled my kombucha. What I think we'll probably do is we'll have a card like this for every map. Right now we only have one map. But it won't be randomly generated on the fly. We'll sort of pre-compute the map. Okay, so that's cool. We have the random map generator. I feel like doing something that isn't so much programming for a second. So one of the things that I noticed we didn't yet have was kind of like like a loading screen, like right before we go into the game. I thought it would be cool to have something that said like now entering, like map, like level name, and then some flavor text or something like that. So here we have like, so someone suggested Code Red at the Super Mall as the name for the map last time around. Luckily we have a famous author in the chat. Robin, if you want to suggest any flavor text here. But I don't know, I was imagining something like... So, for those of you who weren't in the chat last time, we decided the setting of the RPG was going to be, like, in this abandoned mall. So, I don't know. The smell of dusty savings hits you as you begin your... Whoops. Begin your descent into the ancient shopping mall ellipsis. Sure, why not? So I'm going to create with like a brand new card. So I hit Command-M. So kind of how I was thinking this would go is... I'm left-handed, but I used my mouse with my right, so I don't know how well this is going to work. But if I write something kind of says, like, now, that's a terrible W, now, entering that end. So, I'll call this one. This is the field that will have the name of the map, name of the map inserted on it. So we'll want to have the text centered. I don't know, something. Palantino is like the closest thing to, I think the closest thing to like a fancy font that we have here. So maybe something kind of like that. The transparent, yes. I would like to lock the text because I don't want this editable by sort of players as they play the game. And I'm going to have another field that will have that'll sort of scroll the flavor text. So we call this one text. Maybe the text should be a little bit smaller. Okay. So I'm going to write a short script here that on enter card, or no, sorry, card open. Put field name, I think it's name of card map into card field name. So we're going to go to card map. Get the name field, get the contents of the name field, and stick it in our card field, whose name is also name. So I'm going to save that. I'm going to leave the card and come back, and it should be populated, except it isn't. All right, well, that's annoying. Why was that? Oh, I know why. Put, I think, background field name? See if this is actually called name. It is called name. Okay. Oh, did I screw up the name of the opening card? Just open the reference manual here. Yeah, open card. April asks, how ancient is this shopping mall supposed to be? Someone suggested the large shopping mall in the hometown that I grew up in. So we're thinking like 70s splendor. So lots of brushed chrome, that sort of thing. Noraya 1 says, just listen to your hurt. Yes, this is my favorite song on the album. Prepubescent Nathan is having lots of emotions right now. Oh, is the card not called Map? It's called Map. Okay. Well, let's see if I can write an expression in the message window here to try and pull it out. BG Field. Horseman asks, what you sipping on? This is homemade kombucha. A nice tasty beverage for a super hot Saturday night. Okay. So, BG Field Map gives me the thing that I... Wait. Name gives me the thing that I want. So I'm going to move to a different card. Of card map. Okay, that's cool. Oh, well, so... I don't know why that didn't work before. That text is a little big. Horseman says, did you work on this off-stream? Lots of things I don't recognize. The only thing I did off-stream was I moved some stuff around here and I added this text field. But otherwise, it's just the same. I think I may have added, like, the fog off-stream. I can't remember if I did that or not. But those should be the only things that changed. All right, let's move this up a little bit. So now let's do the same thing with... with the flavor text. Okay. So if I leave the card and then come back... Okay, great. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make this a little bit smaller. I should make this bold, maybe. Yeah. There you go. And I'd like to have this sort of scroll by as we read it. So in order to do that, I'm going to write on idle. So I'm going to remember global idle card seconds. So this is the timestamp that when we first open the card. So put the seconds into title card seconds. On idle, I'm going to set this, because I need to global title card seconds in order to see that variable. So set the scroll of the of card field text to seconds minus title card seconds. Let's see if that works. Oh, I should also set the scroll of card field text to zero, just so whenever we open the card, it sort of resets itself. Oh, not a scrolling field. Oh, really? Okay, so I guess I have to make a scrolling style? That's annoying. There we go. So whenever it's idle, it slowly scrolls. Obviously, that's way too slow. So let's speed that up a little bit. Five times... Maybe you can come back. I bet. There we go. Okay. It's maybe a little slow, but that's okay. We can always change it later. So now... I have a card begin. That will just simply go to card... I think I call it game. Okay. Oh, hello, Bruce Fang. Thanks for tuning in. Oh, Horsemans. I think also we started the stream kind of early, which is probably why there's stuff you don't necessarily recognize. So kind of the idea that I was imagining here was, I may have actually forgotten what time it started, so I may have actually screwed that up, which is, only now am I realizing that I screwed that up, so that's kind of embarrassing. But the idea, so going back to kind of what I was saying, the idea is that, like, whenever we start a new map, what we would do is we would go to that card, it would extract the name and text out from out of it. And then, so it would sort of display that, that flavor text, then when you click start, you would actually start the game proper. But right now, as I said, because we only have one map, it's kind of just like the intro to the whole game itself. Okay. So that's, oh, actually, there's an interesting idea. The begin button could also set up our global variables. So remember that when we generated the random map, we always said that our current position was 2-2, which is right here. So just for the time being, why don't we just assume that that's where every level starts? You always start in the top left-hand corner. That's not super realistic, necessarily. But we can deal with that for now. So now, when you click the button, what we'll do is put two... Oh, we'll have global player pause, global player dir. Put 2-2 into player pause. And because we're facing east, because we always have 2-2 and 3-2. I think... 1? Was east? Let's see. So when we click begin... So we haven't yet rendered anything here. But if I go to globals, we see that we've set the player position and player direction to 2-2 and 1. Which is awesome. It occurred to me afterwards that we don't actually have, like, a user interface to actually move the player around the map. So you might remember that we had things like, we wrote functions that did, like, rotate right, and render, to sort of update global state. So if we go to the globals page, it should now be, player dir is now 2. But we can't do it, like, sort of within the game itself. So I think it probably makes sense to do that next. Given that we sort of spent some time building the map generation algorithm, and that was kind of annoying. It was just a lot of, like, programming, so we can keep things nice and visual right now. When I was kind of goofing around with stuff earlier... Oh, hello, Tef eBooks! Thank you for tuning in. Let's have a sip of a thing here. When I was sort of goofing around with it, I had sort of buttons down here to click, like, up, down, left, right. But I kind of want this real estate for, like, health and, like, maybe like a message window or inventory or something like that. So I think it probably makes sense to... someone earlier said, like, can we just make Myst? So what we can do is we can make like Myst style, like a Myst style navigation thing, where you sort of click to the right to move, to turn right, click forward to move ahead, something like that. Which I actually kind of like, because then you actually kind of use this screen real estate for something useful. So let's, I guess, like if you click ahead, that's kind of like the act of moving forward. Do I actually have a... is it in card? No. Is it in background? Okay. So, I guess before we do that, I'll need to write a on player forward. So we'll need global player dir, global player pause. So this is just going to do the thing that you expect, where depending on player dir and player pause, it will just update player pause. So put the first item of player pause into, no, yes, into, first item is calls. The second item of player pause into rows. And then if player pause equals zero, then else if player pause equals one, then else if player pause equals two, then else if player pause equals three, then end if. Okay, so if player pause is zero, then we're facing north. So subtract one from rows. And this will be, and if player pause is 2, that means we're facing south. So add 1 to rows. And we'll do a similar thing for left and right. Garami says, dear not pause. Oh, yes! Yeah, thank you. It's very nice to have the peanut gallery here. Look, who needs a type checker when you have 17 computer people in chat? So if player dir is... So that's calls. And then 3 is west. Oh. Minus 1 to calls. And then what we're going to do is put calls rows into player pause. Let's see if this works. Okay. So look at the globals table. Player pause is 2-2, and player dir is 2. So we're facing south. Grammy says right. So did I screw this up again? Maybe that was from earlier. Yeah, so I think that's right. Right, so okay, cool. No, it's fine. Right, so with player pause, 2-2 are facing south, so it should be 2-3. So if I call the function that we just wrote, which was called player forward, it's now 2, 3. Yes, so that's great. That does the thing it should. So now if we do rotate right, we should now, oops. Yeah, we're now at 3. It's annoying because the N is right, Command N creates a new card, and Command M opens the message bar. So I just created some new cards by accident. So if we do this, we are now facing west. So if we move forward, it should now be 1, 3, right? Horseman says, really, we need to make a HyperCard collaborative editor. Yes, that would actually be super fun. On Twitter, I was talking to some people who are writing sort of HyperCard-inspired, sort of HyperCard clones. So I bet, it seems like a lot of them are like JavaScript people, so if they're doing stuff that's already sort of inherently web-focused, I bet they could totally incorporate something like that. That would be actually pretty amazing. Grammy says, that would be interesting. Different people on different cards, or one using different drawing tools while someone else is editing code attached to it. I guess you'd probably have to lock, like, no two people could edit the same script at the same time. But I guess you could have two people drawing on the card at the same time. That's kind of interesting to think about. So if I try player forward, I should have seen that coming. Tef called it, call it Project Xanadu. Yeah, it's unfortunate that all this stuff is just sort of like 80% of a half-hearted implementation of Xanadu. Okay, great. So now we have 1, 3. So that, I'm satisfied that that works. So now we'll do the same thing, but for backwards. So notice that this doesn't, this has nothing to do with the map just yet. So there's nothing stopping us from just sort of walking through walls. So at some point we'll have to, oh, let me write a 2D here. I'm sure we can't walk through, clip through a wall. Tef says, what if everyone edited a page that's a wiki? I decline to player backwards. Tef says sorry. Somehow I don't think you're sorry. Call it a hunch. Alright, so I'm just going to flip the sign for all of these ones here. Okay. So now that we have that, guess I'd like to save it. I've already forgotten the name of the function that we called it. Zenuteratops says, "You gotta be shitting me, HyperCard." Yes, indeed. Welcome to the stream. So player forward. So when we click the invisible button here, we're simply going to invoke player forward. So kind of what it does is it walks like the hierarchy of like, is there a callback called player forward in the button? If there isn't, it goes to the card. If it's not the card, it goes to the background, and then to the global stack itself. So you don't really have to specify sort of the scope that player forward exists, which is different than global variables, which you have to explicitly define as global, which is annoying. But what are you going to do? So just to confirm that this is going to do the right thing, so we are currently facing west at 1, 3. So if I click forward, it's actually going to move us to an invalid state because we're not checking to make sure we're walking off the edge of the map. So we're now at 0, 3. Cool. So now let's, I guess kind of if you click down here, this will be player backwards. So if we move backwards, you know, is there a way? I feel like we kind of want auto highlight. That's kind of a nice. Oh. Oh, I guess you can't have unary pluses. That should be like that. Okay, so if I click that, we should have gone back to one. Yes, great. So that works. Sorry. I guess this is kind of like the, this will be like the rotate right. And then rotate left over here. Horseman says, I missed that Odon in my childhood. Went from basic on the TRS-80, Coco 3, to Borland C++ and Windows 3.1. Dang. Interesting. Yeah, so I leapt to Visual Basic for, I think that was Windows 3.1, maybe 3.11. So maybe that's kind of my, that was my progression. Less useful than Borland C++, I think. Bruce Spang says, what is this sweet music? There was a request for Rockset, which is what we were listening to last time. So I put that back on. But the Misguy wrote a game in it, right? Splunks? I don't know. A Grammy probably knows, because I know he is definitely a Cyan fan. Not actually sure. Oh, there's actually something that we're missing here. Because when we rotate right, we also want to re-render the screen, right? So do render. And currently render won't do anything here. Except update the update the map here. So when we click left and right, is that working? South. Oh, interesting. Grammy says that Cosmic Osmo, when it crashes, it leaves the drawing tools available. That's super interesting. Were you running the Windows version? Because I guess the Mac version, it might make sense, but I assumed for Windows that they had, I don't know, done it in like Macromedia Director or something. Okay, so we have, you know what would be kind of nice? Grammy says non-emulated Mac, that's right. Yeah, I remember you telling me that you had Basilisk or something running for it. Something that might actually be kind of nice is to have, I don't know, like a tooltip or something that when you mouse over it, it would say something like, move to the right. And then when you move the cursor over a different region, it would say like, move to the left. That's pretty easy to do. So why don't we, I'm just gonna hide the menu bar here. I'll just kind of put it up here maybe. So the field name would be, I don't know, tooltip. I guess that's kind of what I called it. So we'll center it. It's kind of like italics because it's like a whisper or something. Oh, and we don't want it editable. So we'll lock the text. Okay. So what we'll do is on mouse enter, put move to the right into card field tooltip and mouse enter. So when we mouse over a region, that would let us move to the right. Yeah. I guess once we kind of want to reset it when we leave. So mouse leave. See if that works. Yeah. All right. I like that. After spending the first 45 minutes trying to write a maze generation algorithm, it's kind of nice to have some low-hanging fruit just to do some UI stuff and see some quick wins. Okay. Move to the left, move ahead. And this will be move backwards. Move to the right. Yeah, that's cool. All right. So I guess the thing we have to do now is actually glue together like the render functionality with like the map itself. So for those of you who, I think most people were here on the last stream, but just in case you weren't, what we have is we have a card for every, so this is kind of like the top-down view, like a mini map, and I've numbered them in this order here. And so if I scroll ahead, they correspond to, I think this one is called like wall 5 or something. Yeah, wall 5. So if in the view we discover that from the player's orientation there's like a wall here, it will copy and paste this image on top of the game screen. Right? And it'll do that for every one of them. So the reason why it's numbered this way is so it can just go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And if you do it in that order, it'll be overlaid in the right order. Which I woke up in the middle of the night at some point and realized that, which was fun because I never get to have those epiphanies in the middle of the night for my day job. Just because I don't get to write HyperCard for my day job. So to show you an example, I can do... I can't remember what the callback's called. Draw walls. So I think, for instance, if I do draw walls 1 and 2, just like that. We should actually probably, before we go any farther, just gonna delete that. It kind of makes sense to kind of doesn't really make sense to have just like a pure white background or a pure white texture on this, so let's see. I don't think it makes a whole lot of sense to have a lot of detail in this, but I'd like to have something. Something kind of like... Whoops. So I will just so this one is darker than this one. I like that, maybe. Something like that. So I think then when we draw walls, it'll look like it's more Like it's more off into the distance. Yeah, sure. I like that. Why the heck not? Oh, there's no... What? The heck? I don't understand what that was. Okay. But we'll have to do the same thing over here. And I have one weird trick for that. I'm going to copy this one over here, and because it's symmetric, I can flip horizontal. Just like that. And I think, oh, then I guess we need to do this one, don't we? Just fill that in like that. There we go. So I kind of like that. So you have just sort of like increasingly less the tail as it goes farther away. Okay. So as I was saying, we have the draw walls thing here. Yeah, it's seven here. Why not? But the problem is that we don't have a way of saying, like, given our position in the game, given our position in the map and the direction that we're facing, give us this list of walls to render. So I think we should probably write that next. But first, I'm going to get some more kombucha, so I'll be right back. As an aside, if anyone's in the Bay Area and wants a SCOBY, let me know. So I seriously save like $20 a week just by making my own kombucha. All right. So let's go to the maps window. So remember that, like, this is the shared background for all maps. So, oh, for those of you who weren't in the stream when I wrote it, because I screwed up what time this started at, I wrote a random map generator, so we can watch it work again, just kind of while I'm talking. So what we'll do is we'll have the background script. SCOBY Meetup, says Robin Sloan. Yes, absolutely. The more the merrier. Yeah, there's a fermentation shop in my neighborhood that I get all sorts of weird tricks from, so... Anybody wants to come by sometime, let me know. So what was I saying? Right, so we'll write a background script here that will take, I guess, a player direction and it's a position, which will just be the global variables, and will give us like that that list of numbers of walls. If that makes sense. Alright, I think I wrote some notes for this a while back. Yeah. Oh! Gee, in fact, I even wrote something. When did I write this? Well, that's cool. Does it work? Let's see, so Walls North takes a player position. Yeah, Horseman was like, have you done anything since, like, between the... the stream and this one? I was like, no, of course I didn't. And then it turns out I guess I did. Okay, so we extract the two items from player paws. Oh yeah, okay, this makes sense. So we have offsets in this order because, like, first we do this column, and then we do this column, and then we do this column. But because we're facing north, it will be, like, this row, followed by this row, followed by this row. Right. So that's nice. Yeah. Okay. So then if the current tile is a wall, we just add it to the result and then we return it. Okay. So that's cool. But now the real question is, can I write this as walls east? So walls east. Okay, so if we're facing east, let's say if we are here right now, I don't know, exclamation point, and we're facing east, we want 1, 2, 3. So the inner loop is going to be columns going backwards. Right. Okay. Oops. Okay. So inner loop is going to be okay, hang on. Put item J of the inner loop is crap. Inner loop is columns, so that means we have to flip these. I guess I could have just changed I and J around. Okay. And we said the columns want to go in reverse order. So it will be... Man, this is... because we want to look 2 ahead. So it'll be 2, 1, 0. Okay. I think that's right. Columns will be 2, 1, 0. And what about rows? Okay, so if we're facing east, this will be 1, 2, 3. So -1, 1, 0. Okay. So this will be -1, 1, 0 into row offs. Okay. So let's try this out. So let's say we are at 4, 4. So if we see walls north 4, 4, we should end up with 1, 2, 3. 5, 8. 2, 5, 8. Great. So now if I do walls east, 4, 4, I should get 1, 2, 3, 5. Okay, that's not right. I got 1, 2, 3. Interesting. Okay, so I screwed that up. So I want walls east, 4, 4. Okay, so the thing that I want is if I'm at 4, 4. Oh, wait! If I'm at 4, 4. Oh, shoot. Then I want 1, 2, 3, 4, 6. Oh, no, so I did get it right. Okay. Never mind. Let's just confirm, right? Because I'm always looking 2 ahead because I'm standing here. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 6. Okay. So now... I think walls south and walls west are just going to be like flipping signs. Walls south. So if we're facing... If we're facing south, we're going to want the columns in the opposite order. So 1, minus 1. And then for the rows, yeah, we just flip the signs. I think. Does that seem sensible to anyone? Let's try... If I try wall south, 4, 4, at 4, 4, I would expect to have, I guess, only 7 and 8? Oh. Well, that's a problem. Oh, walls south. 7, 8. Okay. Great, so we just flipped the signs. I mean, I guess I could even factor, yeah, I guess we're doing more code duplication than we need here. Okay. Walls west. Walls west. I mean, I guess I just flipped the signs again, but I want to convince myself that I'm right here. So if we're facing west... If we're at 4, 4, we're facing west, I want columns minus 2, minus 1, 0. Okay, yeah. All right, minus 2, minus 1, 0. So if I do walls west 4, 4, I should get 1, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. Well, thank you, Past Nathan, for writing the north one, because that made things a lot less of a pain in the neck than it would have otherwise been. Okay, oh, then I guess what we need is... function walls, player pause, player dirt. So, if walls equals 0, or, sorry, if player dirt equals 0, then... Else if player dir equals 1, then else if player dir equals 2, then else if player dir equals 3, then and if. I guess return walls east, player pause, return, no, sorry, walls north. Grammy asks, is it weird that those list outputs start with a comma? Yes, that is weird. Let me finish writing sort of the dispatcher based on the direction, and then we should take a look at that. Walls north, walls east. Actually, I think I need it to be like that. Player pause, return walls south. West pause. Okay. Um, I do this? I don't think I've ever written a function with multiple arguments before. But first, let's talk about what Guremi talked about. So if I do walls north, Murray Throwaway says, "Hey Nathan, we're at an anniversary dinner, but I just wanted to say I love what you're doing here." Oh, thank you, Murray Throwaway. Feel free to endorse me on LinkedIn for HyperCard, y'all. Actually, maybe that's not a bad idea. I guess there's worse ways to get the attention of Apple recruiters than to, you know, find yourself highly endorsed for HyperCard. So if I do walls north 2-2. Yeah! Why is that? Also, Murray Throwaway, why... are you at like a fancy restaurant and you've just opened your laptop to open the Twitch stream? If so, your partner is very patient. So why do we have... Oh, yeah, totally. That totally makes sense, because the first time through the loop, result is empty. We append a comma and then result. Oh, that's annoying. Yeah. Okay, well, why don't we... Hello, Cambridian. Yes, I am still streaming. Hello. So this is an interesting question. I guess what we could do is we could put thing into walls. And then once we have walls, I can remove the first element, which is the empty string. How do I do that? Can I do something like items 2, 2, 4 of 1, 2, 3, 4? I can't. I'll look this up in a second. I'm still streaming. Wish I could have been there for the first parts. Yeah, so the other parts are up online. I think Twitch deletes streams after like 7 days or something, which is kind of annoying. But you can like upload them like in a post hoc way for like video on demand. So they'll be available up there because I'll just re-upload them. And I'll probably put them on YouTube as well, where they'll just live on Google servers forever. Where it says scripting language, there's a dropdown, probably asking if there are other scripting languages. Currently, there's only HyperTalk. I think at some point you could also use HyperTalk is the only scripting language we have right now. You can also have AppleTalk. Somehow, I've never done it. I'm not quite sure how you make that happen, but somehow you can do that. If you didn't know, you can also write native extensions, where you can call into like Pascal or C code. So famously, that's how the Myst people had color on their backgrounds. They wrote all that in C or whatever and just kind of used HyperCard as a shell. Horseman says, OBS allows you to record and stream simultaneously, which I am doing, yes. So I'm not worried about losing the streams. It's just kind of annoying that they kind of disappear. Thanks, Twitch. So let me look up... how to get more than one is it just item? Oh, okay, item two. Okay, so let me do, so I guess return item 2-2 the number of items of walls of walls. Cambridian says, I was trying to find an answer to that. Google didn't do me no favors. Yeah. as I said, like, I've never really seen it in action either, so maybe it was just one of those things where, like, Apple didn't know what to do with HyperCard, so maybe it was, like, a evolutionary dead end of the product that just never, like, really materialized. Okay. So, I don't actually know how to write a HyperCard function that takes more than one argument. I do, however, have PDFs of a whole bunch of I have a whole bunch of PDFs of HyperCard books, so that I can search through. So under Introduction to HyperCard Functions. Yes. Okay, so the Introduction to HyperCard Functions chapter is 3 pages long. Fine. Well, this is embarrassing. Aha. User defined. So they kind of have like a DNF form for the function signature. And it looks like you can only have one argument in a user defined function, which is super silly. Okay. So I guess we are doing. Walls dot put item 1 to 2 of data into player pause, put item 3 of data into player dir. That's annoying. Tef says Jobs hated it. I wonder why he hated it. Because it seems like, because it's certainly like benign enough. And yeah, I don't know. Look, the best Apple era was, like, the Spindler era, as we all know, so. Which is the era where Apple was losing the most money. There's a commentary there. Can't quite put it together, but. Teffy Book says, function, find min starting line, which word? Oh. Well, we try it. Well, okay, let me, Tef is quick on the internet searching. Let's see if this works. Walls 220. Oh, well, thank you, Tef. That's awesome. That would have been bananas if you couldn't have multiple arguments to a function. So let's just make sure it did the right thing. So we do walls 44. Facing 0, which is north, right? So we should have 2, 5, 8. Yes, and that's what we have. Okay, so that's cool. Because now all we have to do is glue this together with the render function over here. So somewhere around here, I have a function called render. And so currently, the only thing it does is it just forwards the render message to the fields in the card. Oh, interesting. I have a feeling this will break. Oops. Ah! Dang it. I want to open the message bar, but instead I feel like, oh, maybe it's fine. Okay. Maybe it is fine. I was worried that when we created that message bar on top that we didn't have a a render function for it, that something would go wrong. But it doesn't seem like we have a problem there, so that's fantastic. So now what we're going to do is... Oh, geez. Can I do something like... Send... No, I need global player dir, global player pause. Send walls player... Oh boy, I don't know if I can do this. Player pause... Player dir. Graeme says something, sending messages, something that's not listening is fine, I guess. So what normally happens is, the thing that worried me was, if you send a message to like an object that it doesn't know how to handle, it just propagates it to like its parent, which in this case would be like the card. But because the card has the render, like the render message that's like dispatching to like all the fields, you would have like card, field, then back to the card, and then field, and then card, field, and then you would have like Stack Overflow or something like that. That's kind of what I was worried about, but maybe it does some sort of loop detection? That would be interesting. Too much recursion was an error that I kind of remembered having at one point or another. But I guess maybe it's not a problem. Okay, so we're going to send walls to card map. And I'm just going to answer... Oh, no. Wait. I don't know how this is going to work. I think what I'm going to have instead is... walls. I don't actually know how send is going to work in this context because we're supposed to get like something back. Annoying. Let me open up send. Well, let's see what happens. So send walls player pause. Wait. So I'm not even going to do anything with the return value. I just want to see if this actually works. Okay. Can't understand walls. Do I have to do something like go to card map, put into I don't know, walls. So push card, pop card, answer walls. Let's just see if this works. So instead of actually doing the rendering, it'll just pop up a dialog box with hopefully some... Okay. So that's interesting. Where did this... Okay, unrender. I'm going to lock screen. Unlock screen. So the purpose of lock screen and unlock screen is just so we don't see that we go to the map card. This is kind of annoying. I would like to avoid doing this, but I don't know how to do it. So now we're going to render walls. Now, so we're at an invalid position right now. So let's put ourselves at 2-2, which is, I guess, is where we're supposed to start, right? So, and then we want to face east, let's say. Actually, let's do 9-2, or 8, yeah. and then put one into player. So we'll just make sure that's reflected. It is, okay. Did we actually get the... And we are now calling render... No, sorry, draw walls. I think like that is what we want? Yeah. Okay. So let's try... Oh, jeez. That happened again. Gotta figure out what that is. So if we move to the right... Okay. We should see something here, I think. Interesting. So we have... Let's see if this reflects what we expect. So we are standing... Let's figure out where we are. We are at 9-2, facing south. So we are at 9-2. So the... We have the left wall, which is totally... totally occupied, we can't see behind us. No, so we're here. I think it's right. Right, so everything but the closest rightmost one. Yeah! I think that's right. So if we move to the right again, what should we see? If we turn to the right, we'll be facing west. So we should see basically this thing flipped. Right, because then, like, the center... corridor will now be like on the viewer's left. So we shouldn't see anything there. We should just see the other ones appear like this. So I think that's working. Let's try and move ahead. And so we should see nothing but corridor. It's very slow. I'm not sure how much fun this would be to play. But it seems like all the moving pieces are, like, kind of going together. Okay, cool. If I go to the left, I should see nothing except, except wall. Oh, interesting. Yeah, because it's drawing the wall behind it. Oh! Shouldn't I have seen something here? Where are we? We're at 8-2 facing south. 8-2 facing south. Oh yeah, okay. That is right then. Because then we can see the corridor to the left. I don't know, folks. I think like this is kind of looking okay. Interesting. Well this is fun. I don't know, do we want to keep going? Because I'm a dummy, I started the stream an hour early, so we've now been some of us have been in the stream for 2 hours. Do we want to keep going or should we leave stuff for another time. I'm happy to do a little bit more if anyone has any suggestions about what we can hack on next. So some things that we'll have to do, I think we have like one more stream worth of material in the game. Like we'll have to come up with like some sort of combat or like NPCs or mobs. And I'd like to have like player health and stuff like this over here. So that's definitely doable within a stream, given how much we got done today. Not seeing any strong opinions from the stream. Maybe we should just call it an evening then? I'm happy to do that if people want to have big plans for Saturday night. Okay, so Tef says shrug, and it's like 5 a.m. where Tef is, so I feel like if anyone, Tef is going to have the strongest opinion about this. Okay, I think maybe we'll just call it here then. So I guess we can just sort of sum up the things that we built. We wrote the random map generator, which unfortunately not all of you saw, but that was actually less terrifying in the end than I thought it was going to be. We wrote like the flavor text generating thing, which was nice, with the button that sort of generates. Oh, actually, a thing that we're not doing. So this set the global. That button should probably send render to the card, right? Go to card game. Send render to this card. That way. That way we can see sort of a natural, like, we're seeing the right thing right off the bat. Yeah, and then we glued those two, like, the map pieces to the to the renderer, which is pretty great. Yeah, so Horseman says this is a natural stopping point, so cool. Thanks for tuning in, everyone. I'm still amazed anyone wants to watch this happen. So yeah, so I think we'll probably wrap things up in the next stream. And then I have another idea for another HyperCard stream that will be completely different than this. So keep your ears peeled online for that. All right. Have a good night, everybody. If you have comments, send me a toot. I'm Dykstracula on Twitter and all around the internet. Yes, you're very welcome. And we'll talk to you online. And I'll try and do this more often than like every 3 weeks or whatever. So expect the next stream to be sooner than this one was. Okay. All right. Have a good night, everybody. See you later.